just make much of him. What a powerful name that is. Next time, if you don't believe it's a powerful name, next time you're having to stand in line somewhere, maybe at the fast food store, or maybe at McDonald's, or maybe at the bank somewhere, the post office, just start whispering the name Jesus. Talk about him, and see how fast you get attention. People will start looking at you, and they'll start noticing you. Make much of Jesus, and that's what I want to do. It's been a joy to be here today, and I hope you have been blessed and will be blessed as I share the Word of God with you tonight. I want you to know I appreciate the opportunity and look forward any time that I can to come and share the Word of the Lord with you. I want you to turn with me again tonight to the second book of Samuel, chapter number 23. And I want to introduce you to one other of the mighty men of David. There's others in there, but there's another one that I've been particularly drawn to and that I want to share with you tonight. And if you're not acquainted with him, I want you to be acquainted when you go home. You know, the Bible is just such an interesting book. We have managed, most of us these days, we have managed to take the Bible and make it boring. But it is not a boring book if we'll spend time with it and study it and read it. And then just glean all these incidences and characters. Let me tell you something. Everything in the Bible has some kind of spiritual relevance. So don't discard any of it. I know people say, you know, preacher, I was going to read through the Bible, and then I got to the begats, got to the chapter of the begats, you know, the genealogies. Well, I want you to know you may have to work for it, but there's juice in the genealogies. There is an awful lot that can be gleaned from those. I'll agree with you that sometimes it is work. You have to spend a little time with them. But there's nothing in the Bible that don't have relevance spiritually in some way or the other. If you come up on a passage you don't quite understand, my wife was asking me something yesterday. She was reading her daily devotion, and she came up on a passage, and she was asking me something, and it's embarrassing when your wife asks, and you're the preacher, and you can't answer a question. That's embarrassing. And but I told her, I said, Susan, usually when you come to a place like that, the standard rule is just keep reading, and eventually the Bible will answer itself. It will clarify it. It will give you the information that you need. Well, later in the day, I took some time, went to that passage, and I read through it, and I told her later, I said, just like I told you, just keep reading, and the answers are there. You just got to stay with it. So it's an interesting book, and this has been an interesting passage to me. And actually, this character and this passage I want to share with you tonight is what got me into this, the 23rd chapter and the mighty men. Of course, I'd been familiar with them. I don't think I've ever just preached a sermon like I did this morning, but I just was drawn to them. And when I got to studying, I realized there's just too much here to try to get out just in one message. So turn with me to that chapter 23, and I want us to read together verse number 20, the 20th verse, and there's some other fellows that's in here and so forth. But in verse number 20, we're introduced to a man by the name of Benaiah. He was the son of Jehoiada, the son of a valiant man from Kabzeel. He was a man that was raised by a strong, courageous man. He had to have something in him, didn't he? But the Bible said he had done many deeds. He had killed two lion-like heroes of Moab, two men that was lion-like, and he had killed them. He also had gone down and killed a lion in the midst of a pit on a snowy day. Verse 21 said he killed an Egyptian, a spectacular man. The Egyptian had a spear in his hand, and he went down to him with a staff. Leads me to believe that Benaiah could have been a shepherd. But he went down and took the spear away from the Egyptian and killed him with his own spear. These things Benaiah, the son of Jehoiada, did and won a name, made a name for himself among the mighty men, the three mighty men. This man was an interesting man to me. But I want us just to look at him and think about him for just a moment. He was a remarkable man who was actually born to serve as a priest. We learned that from 1 Chronicles 27 and verse number 5. He was born in a priestly order, but he became a soldier. He became a soldier. So much so that he became the captain of David's guard. You can read about that. He had responsibility for the David's secret service, is what we would say. He had killed two lion-like Moabite heroes. He killed this Egyptian, and I believe maybe in 1 Chronicles 11, which is the corollary chapter of this chapter, we learn that that Egyptian was a giant, that he was maybe 7 to 8 feet tall. And Benaiah had killed him with his own spear, took it away from him and killed him. And he was fiercely loyal to the house of David. That theme recurs that I was talking about this morning, how these men were loyal to David. They were devoted to David. He was fiercely loyal. The Bible said that he had made a name for himself among these three. There is a number of men in these chapters, but they're divided sometimes into triads. You'll find different groups of three. And Benaiah is in one of those particular groups. he had made a name for himself. Let me ask you a question tonight. Have you ever made a name for yourself spiritually? There's a passage in the book of Acts. Let me just reference that for a moment. In the book of Acts, chapter 19, in verse 13, you'll read this. Then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists took it upon themselves to call the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, "We exorcise you by the name of Jesus, whom Paul preaches." Now, what happened here is these itinerant Jewish exorcists had watched Paul minister, they'd heard him preach, they saw him cast out demons, perhaps heal the sick. They had saw him do great things in the name of the Lord Jesus. And they decided they wanted to get in on the action. They decided they wanted to do that. And so they decided that they would do like Paul had done, and they would just engage in that kind of ministry. And it said they took it upon themselves. The Lord did not call them. The Lord did not order them. They took it upon themselves to call the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, and they said, "We exorcise you by Jesus whom Paul preaches." But then the next verse said, "And there were seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, who did so." But listen, "And the evil spirit answered and said," he went out there trying to boss the evil spirit around, and the evil spirit, and I imagine he chuckled that little sinister laugh that could come, said the evil spirit answered and said, "Jesus, I know, And Paul I know, but who are you? You see, the Lord Jesus was well known among the ranks of the evil spirits and the demons, and he was their chief threat. And Paul as well, because he was a devoted follower of Jesus Christ, he had not sought to have that extra power. He had just earned it by his loyalty and faithfulness and following Jesus. And he was able to do things not in his own name, but in the name of the Lord Jesus. And hell trembled at the thought of Paul in his ministry. The demons were terrified. And do you know they're still that way today? You let people get serious about the Lord's work, and you let people begin to pray, and they begin to seek to honor the Lord Jesus and to magnify his name and lift him up. And man, they get antsy then, and they want to interfere, and they want to try to do everything they can to stop it. But in this case, this man was trying to prostitute the gift that Paul had legitimately, and the demon said, I don't know you. I've never heard of you. And you know, it's a mark against Christianity and the church when hell does not tremble. It does not recoil at our presence. We should not tremble at the presence of evil in society, but we ought to be as a powerful force in the midst of this world, repelling the powers of darkness that is all around us. Have you made a name? Well, the Bible said Benaiah had made a name for himself. So let's look at this man in this passage. And what I primarily want to look at, there's a lot of things, but I want you to look at the last part of verse number 20. And notice what the Bible said about him. This just interests me. The Bible said he had gone down and killed a lion. I don't know about you, but I'm not wrestling no lion or no bear. But he had killed a lion. But not only that, the Bible said he killed the lion in the midst of a pit. Of all places, he was in a pit. But then the Bible said it was more than just in a pit fighting a lion, but it was in a snowy day. Isn't that interesting? He killed a lion in a pit in a snowy day. Let me suggest some things to you from that text, and let's look at it. He killed a lion, the worst possible enemy. The worst possible enemy. Now, what we need to realize today is as much as we'd like to be nice and play nice and get along with everything and with everybody, we need to realize that we still have enemies, and we're going to contend with them as long as we're on the face of this earth. There is always going to be opposition to those who follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Why are we surprised at that? Jesus said, the world hated me, and they'll hate you also. The world hates us because of our identity with the Lord Jesus Christ. And so there's going to be always that relationship, the worst possible enemies. Let me remind you of 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse number 8, where Peter said, be sober and be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Destruction is all he knows. Death is what it's all about. He don't want to just sideline you. He wants to destroy you. He don't want to cause contention in your family. He wants to destroy your family. He don't want to disrupt things going on at church. He'd like to destroy the church. That's his end game. And the Bible said that he is our adversary, and he's walking around, and he's seeking whom he may devour. Now, what does that mean? That means he's looking for the weak person. He's looking for the weak point. He's looking for wherever and whomever he can gain an entrance in. And wherever he can do that, he's ready to pounce so that he might hurt the cause of Christ and Christianity. We have an enemy that is on the move today, and we need to face him and realize who he is. He is going about as a lion seeking whom he may devour. Benaiah killed the lion, the enemy of his soul. We need to recognize the enemy. I told somebody this morning, and I just read this recently, but it's true that Satan has pulled off one of the biggest schemes against Christianity that is possible, because he has convinced us, by and large, he's convinced people that there is no devil. That there is no devil, and he's free to do his nefarious work, and he is so open and bold about it that he don't even try to hide it anymore. Definitely, he's on the loose, he's on the prowl, and he's moving, and he's seeking whom he may destroy. The lion. Now, the lion, the true lion, the true lion is the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible said he is the lion of the tribe of Judah, Revelation chapter 5 and verse number 5. You do remember, though, the devil is always an imitator, and he's always imitating, or he tries to be like God. That was his initial sin to begin with. In Isaiah 14, you read about how that Lucifer, as the chief angel, set his sights on the throne of God, and he wanted to be like the Most High God. He's always wanted that position of power and that place of honor. He's always been seeking that. But Jesus is the true lion, and the true lion will not harm you. He will bless you. But the imitator, the false, he will destroy us if we don't recognize him and don't counter him. Preacher, you say, how can we counter him? What can we do? Well, we need to learn all about him. The Bible says some things about him. The Bible said he has made himself as an angel of light to start with. The devil don't look like the devil. Sometimes he looks like the most saintly person you would ever see. The most saintly person you would ever imagine. He's transformed himself into an angel of light. He works in the medium of light. Well, isn't that again imitating the Lord Jesus? He said, I am the light of the world. And then again, isn't that mocking and imitating you and I? Jesus said, I go back to the Father, I'm going back to heaven, and you will be the light of the world. And you see, the devil likes to bring, confusion and disruption any way he can. So he just transforms himself into an angel of light, and he does his work in that particular way. We need to recognize him for what he is and how he moves. He has made himself as an angel of light. And then the Bible said he's the accuser of the brethren. He's the accuser of the brethren. You know, I'm not going to get on this. I know that wouldn't affect Fort Creek, but a lot of Baptist churches, I'll just tell you this, you'll know it then, but a lot of Baptist churches, the Baptist grapevine is always, always at work. The gossip line, the accuser of the brethren. And people don't always say, do you know this? But they'll insinuate it. They'll insinuate it. Let me tell you this very quickly. I was preaching up in North Georgia one night in a revival meeting, and I made one of the biggest blunders you have ever saw in your life. I made a statement that just totally, it wasn't, I guess it was pretty bad, I don't know. But anyway, I made a statement that by the time I made it, I knew it was a bad mistake and shouldn't have made it. I'm sure you've never had that happen, but I've had it about every time I preach or something. But anyway, I made this awful statement. And the next day, I was talking to the pastor, and he was kindly ribbing me about that and poking fun at me. I said, you hadn't told anybody about that. Of course, I was thinking about our preacher friends. I said, you haven't told anybody about that, have you? He said, no, I hadn't told a soul. He said, I asked a few if they knew about it, but I hadn't told anybody. Now, that's humorous, and that did happen. That's not just preacher talk. But folks, that's the way it happens sometimes. People don't just come out and say insinuations, half-lies. Why do you think so-and-so did this? What do you think they're trying to get at? And just by that insinuating, things will happen. And do you know that the devil can get into that, and he can use stuff like that to hurt and to harm a fellowship? Because he knows that there is no grander force on God's dear earth than a church of saints when they're together in unity. God's will for the church is to be at unity, and the church of God moves as a powerful force when it's together. But you let little things start to happen. He's the accuser of the brethren. But let me tell you something else. Do you realize that he not only accuses us to one another and accuses anybody any way he can, he accuses us to God. Did you know that? Have you thought about that? He not only is the accuser of the brethren, but he accuses us before the Father. Go back and read the book of Job, and you'll read where Job, where Satan went before the Father and tried to make accusations against Job. He accused us to the Father. He accused the Father to us. You do know that. He accuses the Father to us. You can just go back to Genesis 1 or Genesis 3 and read that. Read in the Garden of Eden where he said to Eve, he didn't say to Eve, you can't eat that. You know what he said? He said, why do you think the Lord don't want you to eat that? You see, it's a subtle insinuation. But you know what? It got the job done. And here we are, fallen sinners, because of his nefarious work. Well, I'm glad Benaiah killed a lion, the worst possible enemy. By the way, the Lord Jesus faced that enemy, and you can go to Matthew 4 and some other places and read where Satan tried to accuse the Father to the Lord Jesus and tried to tempt him and lead him away from God's will. And you know what Jesus did? Over and over and over again, he said, it is written, it is written, it is written. It is written. Do you understand why the devil wants to keep you from God's word, keep us out of the scripture, and not let us really get satiated and full of the word of God? It is because the word of God is our greatest weapon against the devil himself. The Lord Jesus left us a great example. Not only did he practice that, but he left us a great example that we could use, and we need to use it. The worst of enemies. Let me just quickly mention that as Christians, we also have three other specific enemies that is enumerated for us in the Scripture. One is the one that I've just been talking about, and I won't spend any more time. The infernal enemy, Satan himself, or the devil. Satan is the infernal enemy. There is the internal enemy. And we need to do some brushing up on this one, I think. This is the flesh. It's the old man Adam. It's our old nature. When we got saved, the old nature did not get really changed, and it did not get eradicated. We still have that old nature, and we'll have that old nature until we go home to heaven and we get a new body. But we live with that old nature, and we're always having to contend with that old nature, the internal enemy. That's why Paul said in Galatians chapter 5, verse 17, walk in the Spirit, and you'll not fulfill the lust of the flesh. The only way we could overcome the flesh is to walk by faith in the Spirit of God and obedience to His Word. And then, of course, there's the external enemy, and that is the world all around us. The world all around us. Now, when the Bible talks about the world, there's several different definitions that we understand. There is the world itself, the cosmos, the earth that we live on, and this is wonderful. God made it, and it's wonderful. That's not what He's talking about. When He talks about the world as our enemy, He talks about that world that is outside of God's will, that's outside of God's perfect plan, that world that lives in open rebellion against Him. It's that world system that is all around us. That's what Jesus talked about in John 17 when He said, you'll still be in the world, but you're not going to be of the world. But He said, by the way, I'm going to send you back into the world. Why? So that we could be light. We could be a witness, that we could do His will in the world. Saved us out of the world in order that He could send us back into the world and do His will. Benaiah killed the lion, the worst of enemies. And then let me say, secondly, he killed the lion in the worst of places. The worst of places. He was in a pit. Can you imagine how hard it must have been to be in a pit? Now, we're not told why he was in a pit. We're not told how he got in a pit. But I tell you what I do know. Most of the time when I read about a pit in the Bible, it's negative. It's not positive. In fact, most places I think that's true. Most of the time when I read about it in the Bible, it is often used as a trap. It is something where hunters or even tribesmen or armies, they will use it as a weapon to capture something, maybe an animal. Maybe hunters will use it to capture animals for meat and life. And then people could use it, tribesmen, they could use it to capture their enemies or to stop their enemies, but it's always used in a negative light. I think about Joseph in the book of Genesis, how the Bible said that his brothers really wanted to keep him, to kill him. And Reuben said, his older brother Reuben said, no, let's not kill him. Let's throw him in a pit. And one of Joseph's first adversarial positions was to be put in a pit and to be held there. Now, of course, the prison would come later and that would be awful, but he started out in a pit and his life was marked that way. I also think, hallelujah, about the wonderful grace of God from Psalms 40 when the psalmist said, I cried unto the Lord, and He heard my cry, and He lifted me out of a what? Horrible pit. He rescued us. He saved us. He delivered us from a horrible pit, and He set my feet on a solid rock, a solid rock, and He established my going, and He put a new song in my heart. Even praise to our God. That pit's not a good place, and I don't want to be in the pit. But if you find yourself in the pit, sometimes you need to recognize that you've just got to deal with the situation like Benaiah did. He was evidently not only in a pit, but he's in a pit with a lion. And he fought the lion. He fought back. And he killed the lion on that particular day. Then look at the last thought that I want you to see in that text. He not only face the worst possible enemies. By the way, do you have any enemies? Is there anything that's just dogging you right now? Is there a situation you can't overcome? Is there a temptation that you're fighting? There's people that live every day fighting their enemies. Sometimes it's the enemy of the past. What has happened and they just can't seem to get beyond it. Sometimes it's the enemy of an addiction, some kind of sin that won't let you go. There's a lot of enemies that we could talk about, but at the root of all of them is that main enemy that works against us to destroy us. We have to face our enemies. And sometimes the enemy will bring us down to the very pit, the worst possible place that we could ever imagine. He was in a pit, but then the last part not only says it's the worst possible enemy in the worst possible place, but he said it's in the worst possible condition. It was on a snowy day. On a snowy day. Can you imagine how that complicated what happened? Can you imagine how much more difficult it was to fight the lion in a pit on a snowy day? Now, I like snow as good as anybody. Not as good as my wife. She thinks we ought to have snow maybe 365 days a year. I don't know, something like that. I'm not so much. I like a pretty snow. But just as quick as it gets warm enough to start to melt a little bit and everybody runs their vehicles and slings the mud and it gets dirty and messy, I'm done. I'm ready for a rain to get rid of all of it and let's go on about our business. But in the meantime, I'm not anxious to get out on a snowy day, do anything hard, do anything to work. Cold. I'm not good in cold like that. And I can't imagine, I understand there's a lot of people that have to do things like that. Even though the weather, whatever it is, you have to work in the weather. I understand that. But it's not pleasant. It's not easy. It complicates things. It complicates things. Here's Benaiah facing the lion in a pit on a snowy day. But let me go back and read something that changes the story. The changing comes in one word. He killed the lion. He killed the lion. It was the worst possible, but it was not insurmountable. It was the most difficult place. But it's not that it could not be overcome, because it was overcome. And it was in a bad circumstances. And yet, he rose to victory. And you see, we've already read in this text, and I shared with you this morning, how the Bible said the Lord wrought a great victory that day. And I'm here to tell you that our songwriter is right. When he gave us that marvelous song, "Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever." There is victory in Jesus. We may face the worst of enemies. We may face the worst possible situation or place. We may face the most difficult circumstances. But you need to know tonight that because you're a child of God, there is victory in Jesus. I told you this morning I was going to share about this lady, and I want to share this. This is one of the most remarkable stories, and I'm not sure now how I came across this. I had not known about this lady, but I ran across a biography, and I love biography, and I read biographies, and so I read the story of Darlene Deibler. Darlene Deibler was married to Russell Deibler, and I believe they met at Moody. I'm not sure, but I believe it was at Moody where they met, and they married, and their heart was in missions, and so they went to Papua New Guinea as missionaries back in the 40s during World War II. They went to establish a church. They went under the guidance of what is said to be one of the most brilliant missiologists of his time, Dr. Robert Jaffery. I forget exactly what group he was with. I think it was Christian Missionary Alliance, but I'm not sure about that. But he was a brilliant missionary, visionary, and planner, and organizer, and he could rally the troops. And they were doing a great work. They were building a church, and God was blessing them. They'd been there for several years, and then everything went bad. The Japanese took over. They conquered. And these missionaries, Darlene and her husband Russell and Dr. Jaffery and his wife, they were put in the Japanese concentration camp, the women in one place and the men in the other. The last 4 years they were in the prison, she never saw her husband, and he never saw her. Horrible. The Japanese prisons was just horrible. They were delivered. The Allied troops got to them about 7 or 8 days after the signing of the truce that ended World War II. But by the time they got to Darlene Deibler, her husband, Russell, was dead. Dr. Jaffery himself was dead. And when she left Papua New Guinea, left two white crosses on the hillside, and she was only 28 years old. She was now a widow. She was returning home without a single possession. All of her mementos, all of her private keepsakes, everything was gone. And all of her loved ones was dead. They were dead. Her body was debilitated. If you've ever read anything about the prisoners in concentration camps, you know a little bit about that. She was debilitated by exhaustion, starvation, malaria, and beriberi, and dysentery. Just literally destroyed her body almost. For almost 4 years, she had witnessed the atrocities that can scarcely be described. Prisoners all around her had suffered horrible, horrible deaths. And she herself had seen inside the death cells. During that period of time, not one letter, not one package, not one correspondence had come from home. You're talking about facing a lion in a pit on a snowy day. Can you imagine? Can you imagine? Well, she was rescued from the prison. They carried all the prisoners and put them on a boat, and she was leaving. But as she was leaving, Darlene Deibler prayed a bitter, bitter prayer. She said, "Lord, I'll never come to these islands again. They've robbed me of everything that is most dear to me. Nothing left. Her health gone. She's leaving." And she almost as if shakes her fist in God's face and says, "I'll never come again. I'm through." Threw up her hands to quit. But as they were leaving the harbor, suddenly she heard voices. And it was the voices of Indonesians singing from a distance. There on the shore were those who had come to know the Lord through her ministry. Those that she had introduced to Jesus. Those who become Christians because of the ministry that she had been involved in. And there they stood on the shore as the ship was sailing out. And they were singing, God be with you till we meet again. By His counsel guide uphold you. With His sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again. Darlene Deibler would later write in her autobiography, Evidence Not Seen. She said, the song released the waters of bitterness that flooded my soul and the hurt that began to drain from me as my tears flowed in a steady stream. The healing had begun. She said, I knew then that someday, God only knows when, I would come back to these, my people, and my island home. Now that stirs me. I don't know about you, but I see the worst of enemies, the lion. I see the worst of places, the pit. I see the worst of situations in the snowy day. But I see the hand of our God that can enable us to defeat the enemy in the pit on a snowy day. She would later marry another man. His last name was Rose. She became Darlene Deibler Rose. And he and her together went back to that island and started the ministry all over again. And God used them in a great way in that place. I don't know where you may be. I don't know how you may be living. I don't know what your enemy is. I don't know what your pit is. I don't know what kind of snowy day circumstances you have. But what I do know is the God we serve can do great things in the midst of all of that. And victory can come and will come. Let's pray together. Father, I stand here at the close of this message in this place, and I'm almost convinced that maybe I needed this more than anybody else, just to be reminded that the God I serve is greater than any situation that we'll ever face, no matter what it is. Every period of our life has unique circumstances, and every period of our life has unique enemies. But it doesn't matter, because the God we serve is the God that can give us the victory. Lord, there may be somebody here tonight that's holding on by a thread. Maybe things are going on in their life and they don't know how they're going to face tomorrow. Maybe they're here tonight and they're dreading this next week. Help them to know that God is with them and for them and will help them to be victorious. I pray you'll bless the close of this service. Lord, if there's anyone that needs to respond, I pray that they'll come tonight in the name of Jesus. As we close tonight, could we just have a verse of invitation, and altar is open. I don't know what it may be. We'll sing just one verse, and somebody needs to come, then we'll sing another verse. But listen, God's in business tonight. Do you need Him? Do you need His help? Come to Him. He wants to help you. Let's stand together and sing tonight, all right?
294.
Have thine own way.
Now, Father, we thank you for the day and for all of its blessings. Thank you for your presence with us. Thank you for the opportunity to be here and to preach today. And I pray you'll honor your word and use it to speak into some life that needs to hear a word from the Lord. Dismiss us now in your love. Keep us in your grace. Guide us through this next week. Help us to be a blessing and a witness as we go. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. God bless you, and you're dismissed. Amen.